Good morning. Good morning. And welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Greater Naples. My name is Tony Fisher. I serve this congregation as minister. How's that? I think I need more volume, Dan. Just a little. Well, let's start over. Good morning. And welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Greater Naples. My name is Tony Fisher. Grateful to serve this congregation. We have a wonderful service for you this morning. As you'll be reminded multiple times in the course of the next hour, an annual meeting immediately following the service. So any of you members that are here, please take that into account. This morning we have the joy to welcome back to the sanctuary Natalie Rosen, who was a guest with us earlier this year. Natalie is a student at FGCU pursuing a degree in music performance. She plays with the school and community orchestras around Southwest Florida and thoroughly enjoys collaborating with other musicians in a variety of chamber ensembles and productions. Recently joined the Pit for an FGCU production of Heathers, the musical. We're looking forward to hearing of Natalie's successes in the future as she pursues her dream of playing in a professional orchestra and continuing her service work in the community. So welcome, Natalia. Good to see you. And welcome to Cliff Wells. And welcome to Cliff Wells, who's our worship associate for today. Cliff has been given the task, the multiple tasks of the worship associate, up to the very, very last second. So,
hey, I'm a UU. We could do this. Thanks, Tony, and welcome again to everyone. So happy to see everybody still, even though we're coming on summer, filling the sanctuary. Out on the patio, we have a lot more members, and we also, of course, have people online. And we welcome all of you, whether you're at home or on the road someplace. We have a special welcome this morning for the coming of age youth who are here. They're beginning to finalize their efforts for this year, and we invited them, of course, to be in the sanctuary with us. Because our special guest in that regard is locally known author and naturalist Amy Bennett Williams, joining us today. I know you know her name. Thank you. Amy's a longtime writer for the news press. She started out writing obits, but has obviously moved well beyond that, and now has the coolest job title you can imagine. She's called a storyteller. So many of us know her from her wonderful segments on WGCU, where she regularly shares stories of family, friends, and neighbors, and also extols the beauty found in the commonplace objects and places here in Southwest Florida. Amy is the author of a pictorial history book along the Caloosahatchee, hello, and is now at work on another book, so she will be seeing that soon. She and her husband, Roger, also a writer, live in Alva, near the Caloosahatchee, with their two sons and way too many animals, I'm told. So welcome, Amy. So if you're new to our congregation, and there are many new members here, we are especially grateful that you found us. Our intent is to make you feel welcome and help you find ways to connect with us all. Because today happens to be our annual members business meeting, right after the service, we'll be a bit short on time to chat with you new members, but please stay to learn more about our operations of our congregation. And now, please take two deep breaths with me so that we can settle in and get our minds relaxed. So here's the first one. And number two. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Between rocking the boat and sitting down, between stirring things up and peaceably going along, we find ourselves here in community. Each called from many different journeys, many different life paths onto this river road. Some are here because the rocking of the boat has been too much tumult, too much uncertainty, too much pain. Some are here with questions about where the boat is going, how best to steer it, where this journey ends. Others are here as lovers of the journey, lovers of life itself. Here in front, beside, behind, each a passenger, each a captain, doing the best we can. Rest here in your boat. Listen to how I flow, the river says. The sound of life coursing all around you. Let the current hold you. Let the current guide you. Let the river that gently flows through your soul whisper, come, let's worship together. Please join me in the chalice lighting words on the screen or on your order of service. May we know once again that we are not isolated beings, but connected in mystery and miracle to the universe, to the community, and to each other. And let's rise in body or spirit and join in singing our opening hymn, number 1007 in the Teal Book. We are nodding to World Water Day, which was on Friday, this past Friday, with a couple of our hymns. There's a river flowing in my soul.
There's a river flowing. going in my mind. There's a river flowing in my mind, and it's telling me that I'm somebody. There's a river flowing in my mind. There's a river flowing in my mind.
Thank you. Sounding wonderful. Welcome, Amy Bennett Williams, to Unitarian Universalist Congregation of Greater Naples.
Thank you.
So good to have you with us.
Glad to be here.
Many of us know you from your WGCU on-air segments on Fridays still?
Actually, they have become more intermittent as I changed beats. I'm now doing the environment, and they're more like monthly or quarterly, but they're available online always.
Always, good.
Yeah.
And I know that you were involved in a couple of environmental assignments this week, having to do with water, by
yes.
the way. Yeah.
Yeah, there's a story out today about Calusa Waterkeeper's fecal bacteria sampling program, which is, you know, necessary.
Right. Well, we're all about organic things here, so
yeah,
it's
exactly.
All right. So I'm curious as to how, you know, what was your background? What got you involved in journalism in the first place?
Pure accident. I grew up in Illinois and was going to be a veterinarian, but I didn't math very well. So I became an anthropologist and came down to Florida, to Marco Island, with my grandparents as a kid for spring break and winter break, and fell head over heels in love with this place, with the way it looks and smells. And so when I had graduated with an anthropology degree and a healthy distaste for academia, which was really cutthroat where I was, I was kind of adrift and went to grad school, studied fiction and poetry, which also wasn't really turning out to be a way to make a living. But I came down here anyway, still smitten. And long story short, got a job as a clerk slash reporter at the news press because theirs had just quit and they needed someone desperately. This was the days of hard drinking, chain smoking, grizzled old news guys. And one of my very important jobs was emptying the ashtrays. So they would put kitty litter in a Folgers can, and I would dump the butts. But there was the opportunity to write obituaries, and I put my hand up and jumped at it and saw them as stories of people's lives and kept writing ever since. So no background, no journalism school, just curiosity and luck.
Wow. And I'm assuming your anthropology degree, your interest in culture and people, obviously.
Yes, I tell myself that I'm still committing anthropology regularly.
Committing anthropology. I like that a lot. So, as you know, today our subject, our theme is communication and the art of communication. Our coming-of-age youth are in the process, some of them anyway, of writing sort of their own story of where they are on their journey right now. So when we talk about communication, what do you think are the important elements of communication? We didn't practice this, but talk about that.
I think that the first thing is being quiet and going deep. I think that before you communicate outwardly, you have to check yourself pretty well and know yourself and maybe walk around the spectacular garden that you all have here and really get a sense of what's inside. And once you're sure of that, then you can begin putting it outside. Mm-hmm. I'm a journalist now, so I'm all about simplicity. And it doesn't have to be fancy or curlicued or ornate. I think that you can just start with some really basic things and ornament it as you go. Right.
Some of our youth have questions to ask, and Cliff has a microphone. Who has a question out there that they want to? Ada? What are some ways to get better at communicating?
Boy, I hate to use the muscle analogy, but I'm going to. Just keep doing it. Push past discomfort, which is inevitable, and just keep going. And forgive me the cliche. I know you've heard that before, but it's what I did, and I can tell you from experience that it works. And then the other thing to do is be as absorbent as you can. Read, watch, sort of put yourself in spaces where there are people whose communications you admire or like or are challenged by, and you'll find that will inform your own communication.
Great. Elliot? Who were your mentors?
I would say, again, because I don't really have a journalist background, I had an 11th and 12th grade English teacher who was the cool teacher, and we didn't have to call him Mr. Athanasius. We called him Steve. So Steve, I would say Steve was my first mentor. He was the person who taught me when I was maybe your age or a little younger that the essence of communication and the basics comes from the sensory world. He taught me that if you want to communicate with someone, if you can describe the way something looks, sounds, smells, especially, that the people who are receiving your communication are going to have an easier time because we all live in bodies. And if you can do that, if you can ground your communications in the physical world, it's a great starting point. So I would say that Steve was my first mentor. Once I got to the newsroom, there were some kindly veteran journalists who would sit side by side with me and say, why don't you try phrasing it this way, or maybe cut that. And then finally, my own kids. Having to explain the world to a couple of curious kids was hugely helpful for me. And I still try to run stuff by them. And their curiosity and their interest in the world has really helped me be a better communicator.
All right, great. Anybody else? Jacob.
Never.
The question was, at what point in your journalist career did you feel comfortable speaking in public?
That's a really good question. And I suppose, I don't think comfort is really the word for it, but I'm accustomed to it. I am an off-the-charts introvert, but I learned that if I was going to do the work that I really wanted to do, which is this work, that I would just have to push past it and practice and become routinely uncomfortable. And so am I used to it? Yes. Am I really comfortable? No. I so admire the stagey people who can do that. And I try to watch them. But I wouldn't call this comfort. Just being honest.
Well, you know, some of the sort of deepest introverts stand up here and preach every Sunday. So
yeah, I think introverts run the world.
Ryan, you got something?
So, what is the toughest assignment you've ever been given?
It kind of depends on how you define tough. But there was a period about 15 years ago when I was on the child welfare beat. and I had to cover stories of parents and others who had done horrific things to kids. And at the time, my boys were little boys. And one of the things I try to cultivate is empathy. And that was really tough. And I'm still working on that. But I would say that the toughest thing I've ever done is writing about and communicating about people who are in such pain and in such terrible straits that they hurt their kids.
Great. Do any of you have any other questions? You'll have another chance that if you come up with something and you want to ask Amy, we'll have another opportunity. Yes. How to be a good listener?
Keep your phone in your pocket. I would just say be willing to be quiet. And this too is something that I'm working on. There's a very human tendency to want to anticipate what the person who's speaking to you is going to say next and to sort of step on them and, you know, oh yeah, I get that, and, you know, to maybe show off a little bit how much you know about what they're talking about. If you can squelch that, and maybe the whole business of taking notes is really useful. I think that there's a brain-hand connection that can actually help you listen. I don't know what the mechanism is, but so really try to shut down that little monkey voice in your head and center.
But yeah, that sort of leads into one of the questions I had. You know, obviously communication is vital to human beings. This is what we do. We are the communicating species. Given that, why is it so difficult for us to communicate and, you know, sort of do that well?
That's another great question. And maybe because we are primates and the development of verbal communication is relatively late in our evolution and we're still getting better at it. You know, I think that we're really good at, if we can see and hear, reading faces and voices and the nonverbal aspects of communication, and sometimes the verbal stuff is tough, and I don't know why that's just my theory. And again, I think that you can get better at it with practice. But like many good things, it's worth the effort.
Yeah, absolutely. And Ed, one more, yes, please. Ed? Is this long or is this short? I just have to ask.
You've got a meeting coming up.
Go ahead.
In grammar school, we were given our first assignment to write a story, a page story. All I struggled over doing so terribly. It was a difficult chore. And when I was finished, I was so proud to give it to my father. He was a bright man, and he read the story, and he turned to me and he said, "What have you said?" And I said, angrily, I said, "Well, I've written it down for you." And he said, "Tell me what you said." And so I told him verbally what the story was. Ah, he said, "That's what you should write."
Yeah, wise man.
Yeah. So that sort of leans into a question about what we're expressing in our writing. So what values do you hold as a journalist, as a writer, that are important?
Telling the truth, finding the truth wherever it is. As I was preparing for this, I went back over my company's ethical principles. And one of those is, and I'm paraphrasing, is that we will seek truth in obscure corners and bring it to light. That's one of the things that's really important for me. Currently, I'm working on the environment. So you know, whether it's fecal bacteria in our rivers, or people bulldozing gopher tortoise burrows, or Corkscrew Swamp Sanctuary having trouble with willows and drying up. Those are the kinds of things that I think it's important to bring to light. But also, what's going on with struggles for social justice and what's happening with our explosive growth. Mm. And I think that by finding those things, bringing them simply in front of an audience and then just presenting them and letting people think about them and draw their own conclusions, because I'm not an editorial writer, those are my values, to sort of find things that we as a community need to know about and present them to the community.
And so I assume then from your response that those values don't shift from being a journalist to being a storyteller and speaking in public, writing to speaking.
Not really. The storytelling business, and I'm sort of a weird hybrid character in the newsroom because I have, when I choose to have it, a column that is a first-person column that's called Field Notes, and it's about my experience of life here in Southwest Florida. And I think the only thing that's different in those columns occasionally is that I do sort of have a not-so-secret mission, and that is to get everyone else to fall as hard in love with this place as I am. And then I think that once people do, that there will be the inclination to preserve and protect these things that are so spectacular.
That's great. All right. We're going to take a little break from our conversation. We'll come back up here in a bit. But for now, let's settle into our time of joys and sorrows with our centering hymn, How Could Anyone? It's number 1053 in the Teal Hymnal. Amy, feel free to have a seat, and we'll sing.
Anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul. How could anyone ever tell you you were anything less than beautiful? How could anyone ever tell you you were less than whole? How could anyone fail to notice that your loving is a miracle? How deeply you're connected to my soul.
We join together amidst the tumults of our individual lives, brought together by the desire for community to share in a moment of joy or sorrow, a laughter of pain. This week we are painfully aware that violence happens everywhere across the world, and we mourn the lives of so many people lost in Moscow this past week to terrorism. We recognize that terrorism takes many different forms and affects our lives in ways perhaps we don't all understand, except that we feel the grief and the sorrow, except that we feel that it never seems to end, and it's hard to catch our balance. Yesterday afternoon, in a small gathering here on the pavilion, we celebrated the life of Maureen Armour, one of our longtime and valuable members of this congregation. She was celebrated in story and by tipping a glass of Prosecco, one of her favorite beverages. It was a wonderful small gathering, and we will miss her, those of us who remember her. Today, I will ask you if you have a joy or a sorrow to come forward and light a candle at any point during the service, during the musical meditation, or any other time you would feel it right. The candles are there for you. We will forego this week only our spoken joys and sorrows. So let's join together right now in the spirit of meditation. Spirit of love and life. We wonder how we find our voice as individuals and as a community. How do we express ourselves authentically? If we are wise, we know these are questions that follow us throughout our lives, knowing we are never complete, never perfect. For to believe we've arrived, that we all know all there is to know, that we can't or won't be changed by a changing world, would be a tragedy of its own. So how do we find our voice? We remain open to transformation. We reflect on our beliefs. We consider our values. They should ground the words we write and the stories we tell. We practice humility. We seek out role models, women and men whose words and deeds have made a difference in our lives. We let our humor shine through. We don't rely on technology. We don't get stuck trying to be perfect. We learn to listen and keep listening. We practice, knowing that practice breeds confidence. How do we find our voice? We listen to our hearts. We never stop learning. We never stop reflecting. We never stop sharing, even when our sharing isn't perfect. Let's take some time together in silence.
Before we start this one, we had just a couple of vocabulary notes. You probably already know this, but mycelium is the equivalent of roots that fungus have, fungi, and hyphae are the little fiber-like things that connect. So this is a reading by poet and sometimes essayist Ross Gay. In healthy forests, which we might imagine to exist mostly above ground, and be wrong in our imagining, given as the bulk of the tree, the roots, are reaching through the earth below, there exists a constant communication between those roots and mycelium, where often the ill or weak or stressed are supported by the strong and surplus. By which I mean that a tree over there needs nitrogen and a nearby tree has extra. So the hyphae, a word so close to hyphen, the handshake of the punctuation world, the fungal ambulances ferry it over. Constantly, this tree to that, that to this. And that in a tablespoon of rich fungal duff, a delight, the phrase fungal duff, meaning a healthy forest soil swirling with the living the dead make, are miles and miles of hyphae, handshakes, who get a little sugar for their work. The pronoun who turned the mushrooms into people, yes, it did, evolved people into mushrooms. Because in trying to articulate what, perhaps, joy is, it has occurred to me that, among other things, the trees and the mushrooms have shown me this. Joy is the mostly invisible, the underground union between us, you and me, which is, among other things, the great fact of our lives and the lives of everyone and the thing we love going away. If we sink a spoon into that fact, into the duff between us, we will find it teeming. It will look like all the books ever written. It will look like all the nerves in a body. We might call it sorrow, but we might call it a union, one that, once we notice it, once we bring it into the light, might become flower and food, might be joy. Thank you.
So when you sent that reading, it's a reading that requires, I think, multiple readings because it's so rich and dense. But that idea of connection that we don't see is so, I think, valuable. Communicating in ways we don't even think about, and for better or for worse sometimes. But, I hope if anybody wants a copy of that, please let me know and I will send it to you. It's very rich, and there's also a book that speaks to the secret life of trees, which is really incredible in terms of its letting us know that the world is much more than we imagine it to be. So, in your own writing, what inspires you to want to write a particular story or write at all? Or what inspires you to want to connect through this medium, written or spoken word?
I think it's partly that I'm a primate, partly that I am crazy about this. I just love this place. And as I said, I really want others to as well, because selfishly and for the lives of my children, I want it to persist in a condition that's as close to health as we can make it. Mm-hmm. And that inspires me, it spurs me, it wakes me up at 3 a.m. It's not always a pleasant wash of sunshine. Sometimes I think, if I don't write about this, if I don't communicate about this, if I don't raise the flag, we're really going to be in trouble, and we probably are going to be we are in trouble, but I think the more we talk and think and work about it, the better.
So drilling down into that, and as you're talking, recognizing how vital communication is and how we do it, and how well we do it, how much care we put into it, is so critical. And it has to do with our one-on-one conversations as much as it has to do with how we communicate more broadly than that. And if we can just get it right and learn to listen, maybe there would be some health in the world that we could bring to the world. But it's really hard.
It is, but good things are hard. You know, it's that. At least that's what I tell myself.
Yeah. I wanted to ask our youth if any of you have come up with any question during our conversation here that sort of has risen up for you. I want to make sure we answer your questions. After the service, Amy will have an opportunity to sit with our youth for 20 minutes, a half an hour, whatever works, as all our guests have during our coming of age segments this year in the sanctuary. So let me ask you, sort of help you, something that Brad brought up in terms of something you might reflect more deeply on is that how, because our kids are working to try and express themselves, and we all know it's not all that easy, what we ask of our youth at this time to write something that is about them, of them. How, for you, Amy, how might, this is from Brad, how might we know who you, Amy Bennett Williams, are through what you say, write, and connect with others? How do you come through your writing?
If I'm being a good journalist in the strictest journalist sense, I don't. That's one of the things about the art that I practice, is that my mission is to let facts and other people speak for themselves. It's a different story when I'm doing columns, and then you see the world as filtered through my eyes and experiences. And if you were to look at the sweep of my work, you'd see a lot of outside, you'd see a lot of animals, you'd see a lot of kids, you'd see a lot of peculiar thoughts about the peculiarities that surround us. I would say that in my columns, one of the things that I try to do is describe what strikes me. And I think that when you're working on your statements of personhood, that's something that your audience is going to want to read. What it is that you see, what the sounds are that really catch your attention, who the people are you find interesting. And by knowing what's interesting to you, your audience will know you as well. And I think that if someone were to read my stuff carefully, that's probably all in there.
So, and I think there's a certain bravery required to put yourself, those experiences, those senses, all of who you are into that, those pieces of your work, to put it out there. And as an introvert,
no kidding. And sometimes it gets downright cringy when I look back at stuff that I did. But you know, that's all we've got as humans, as primates, and it's I feel like that's what we do need to do.
Well, I want to thank you so much for being here with us, for spending some time later with our youth, and for sharing in public.
Yeah. Thanks to you all. I'm grateful for the chance to speak with you, and what a beautiful congregation you are and have. So thanks so much.
Thanks, Amy, very much.
Wow, to have you share your expertise and your values with us has really been special. Have you given any thought to moving to Tallahassee or Washington, D.C.? We need more. So this congregation offers us so much. Oops, yep, that's correct. Offers so much. Wonderful programming, engaging worship, excellent music, a wonderful staff, this great facility with this incredible garden, and a welcoming, diverse community with whom to share our lives and journeys. All of that happens because of dedicated volunteers and loving members. Unfortunately, FPNL does not allow us to pay our bill with love. They prefer funds. So whether you have submitted an annual pledge or not, please consider sending a gift today, which will be gratefully received. The information that you would need is on your screen. Thank you. was wonderful. Thank you so much. And thank you, Missy, for sponsoring this. So here's some reminder of what's happening today and throughout this week at UUCGN. As always, a list of things. If you're a member of this congregation, your attendance is requested right after this service for our annual business meeting. You'll have just enough time to grab some coffee on the pavilion before we reconvene to begin the proceedings. That will be at 11:15 in 19 minutes from now. The Pavilion Concert Series continues today at 4 p.m. with pianist Fernando Lopez Flores, who brings his amazing talents of classical performance, original improvised music, and multicultural music to our sanctuary. If you were present to hear Fernando last week or a couple of weeks ago, there's nothing more we need to say. He's really fabulous. Another great offering from the church. Wonderful Wednesdays this week presents an art workshop with Sherry Arnes. Come discover your inner artist and free up your mind. In 2 weeks, on April 7th, the Interfaith Alliance, along with Gleason, Naples Pride, and PFLAG, will hold a Pride convocation at 4 p.m. And that's at the Naples United Church of Christ. Please pay attention to the email news blast to find out more. I have an update on the weekend meals. It began last week, and thanks to your contributions, we have already received donations to feed 48 students out of 160 is the goal. Here's how you can have a direct impact and transform the life of a child who may be lacking some nutritional security this year without our help. This year, you can sponsor a child for 1 year. That's 38 weeks of weekend meals for only $300. We can do it for that inexpensive amount because of Missy's dedication from her team to pack and distribute those boxes to schools. It's an incredible project. You can also co-sponsor a child for $150. Whatever you feel comfortable giving, please send that check in to the office and be sure to mark it weekend meals in the memo slot so that we know where to apply those contributions. If you want more information about news about the weekend meals in the weekly newsletter, check that out to find a direct link to where you can make that deposit. It's a very worthwhile program. And Missy will be out at a table after briefly on the pavilion. So if you have questions, you can ask her about that. And finally, next week is the flower service. So please bring a flower to the congregation for that service. If you can find one, you can just snip it from your neighbor's yard, whatever. So now let's rise in body or spirit and sing together our closing hymn. It's number 100 in the gray hymnal, I've Got Peace Like a River. We'll sing verses 1, 2, 5, and then 3.
I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river, I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain, I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got tears like the raindrops, I've got tears like the raindrops, I've got tears like the raindrops in my soul. I've got tears like the raindrops, I've got tears like the raindrops, I've got tears like the raindrops in my soul. I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean, I've got love like an ocean in my soul. I've got love like an ocean. I've got love like an ocean. I've got love like an ocean in my soul, in my soul.
When is a benediction not a benediction? When we'll turn around and gather again in 15 minutes. But as we gather for worship, so may we gather to do the work of our congregation with peace, love, and the joy of community in our hearts, and with our mission clear before us, striving to build the world we dream about. Go in peace, go in love. Have a wonderful day.